guest, our special guest, Dr. Philip Bagus, who is an assistant professor in the University of Juan Carlos in Madrid. He is also a friend of Professor Huerta de Soto. He recently published two very important books, one about Iceland meltdown and the other one about strategy of the euro. This book was translated into Polish and published recently by our institute. He is going to give a lecture on problems within the eurozone and problems concerning the future of European Union and its monetary policy, but not only about monetary policy. So please give a warm welcome to Dr. Philip Bagus.
So everyone, I'm very happy to be here to speak on my book, The Strategy of the Euro. Indeed, Polish was one of the first languages, maybe the first it was published into. Until now it has been published in English, Slovak, Polish, Bulgarian, Italian, Greek is forthcoming. actually, there was. I was surprised that there was a volunteer who really wanted to wrote me and said I want to translate it. I said, okay, no problem. Go ahead, and then we later look for a publisher. A Romanian translation is forthcoming, and Spanish, Portuguese. German did in a month ago. A month ago, yeah.
Hopefully they will win.
I hope so too. 100 copies per week are sold until now. Not so much, but because obviously it's the perfect market for the book. But I hope it can increase and finish also. But I was surprised that from the interest that was immediately from Central and Eastern Europe, from Poland and Slovakia, Romania and Bulgaria, even some of those are not even in the euro. No? This maybe has to do with the fact that euro leads to some sort of empire that the Soviet Union was. No? This might have to do something with it. Let me tell a little bit how I came to write the book. I actually started writing about the monetary mechanism of the euro. I wrote some Mises Daily articles, and then after this I started to investigate the history of this construction. And this was really amazing reading for me, because there were many things I didn't know. And they integrated very nicely with the fatal monetary setup. And this makes the story in the books so nice, in my opinion. The integration of the political analysis or Austro-libertarian analysis of the introduction of the euro and its setup. So in order to understand the euro, I think you have to approach it from these two ways, from the political and from the monetary side. I begin the book with stating the two visions that has been for Europe. On the one hand, the classical liberal or the libertarian vision, the founding fathers were still closer, even though there were no pure classical liberals, but they were still closer to this vision, like Schumann, Adenauer, Alcide de Gasperi, who all were Christian Democrats. They were still influenced by the experience of the Second World War and thought that free trade would bring peace to the European nations. For this vision, the most fundamental Christian and European value is individual liberty. In this vision, there are sovereign European states that defend property rights, have open borders and free exchange of goods, capital, ideas and people. The Treaty of Rome of 1957 was in fact a step towards this vision or a success for it. The only bad part of this treaty was, of course, the common agricultural policy that came from the, you guess it, from the French from French initiative. So this vision wanted to bring back what classical liberalism had already achieved in the 19th century and what had been lost in the age of nationalism and socialism in two world wars. So for this vision, for harmonic cooperation Europe only, we need only liberty. We don't need a European super state and regulations. So actually this vision sees the European super state as a danger to individual liberty. And also, as the founders were Christians, they saw strict borders for the European Union that were Christian countries. And they subscribed to the Catholic principle of subsidiarity. So the idea to solve political problems at the lowest political level possible. Also in this vision, there's only one central institution, which is the European Court, that defends the four liberties, four basic liberties, freedom of capital, goods, and movement of persons. On the other hand, we have the socialist vision, very prominent in these days. Prominent defenders were Jacques Delors and François Mitterrand, and they are backed by a coalition of nationalists, socialists, and social conservatives. They see or want to see Europe as an empire or a fortress, protectionist to the outside and interventionist to the inside. And they dream of this European central state directed by technocrats, and in their dreams, of course, they are those technocrats. In this vision, then, there stands the empire against the peripheral states. And the empire controls the peripheral states, and the sovereign states stop to exist. There's central legislation, there's redistribution, regulation, and harmonization of taxes, of course, on the highest level. And today, the vast majority of the political class, the bureaucrats, interest groups, lobbies, the subsidized sectors, they all are in favor of this vision of the center. They want the central state basically to enrich themselves, to use it as a means to satisfy their perverse ends. Finally, the sovereign states become subjects to Brussels in this vision. This idea of a big European state is not nothing new. This idea of a one central European state had been in the minds of Charles the Great, Napoleon, Hitler, and Stalin. They wanted a central government in Europe. They used military means. Now the socialist vision uses political means, which appear to be less violent. One of the tactics is the tactic that Robert Hicks describes in his book Crisis and Leviathan. Always when there's a crisis, they use this to push forward toward this central state. They introduce new institutions and at the same time assume more power. And we can see it now that the Commission behaves like Greece would be their protectorate, or Ireland and Portugal. They tell them what to do. It's a protectorate against the evil speculators, supposedly, and they tell them how to reduce the deficit. The ECB also expanded their power. They expanded their balance sheets. They started to buy government bonds directly on the market. There were new institutions installed, the EFSF, the European Financial Stability Facility, and then comes also the European Stabilization Mechanism. So the crisis is used to expand power and to introduce new institutions. Obviously, there's a conflict between the two visions. It's a fight of humanity. There's always liberty against socialism. Also here in about the European Union, because more power for the central states means less power for less liberty. So who is on which side in this battle? Well, traditionally, because today it's not so clear anymore, the Christian Democratic parties were closer to the classical liberal view. Germany, the Netherlands, and Great Britain were also more in favor of a free trade European Union. And on the other side stand the Social Democrats, the Social Democratic parties, the socialists of all parties, under the leadership of France. France, after the humiliation of 1940 and after the loss of the colonies, its political elite was looking for a substitute for the lost empire, and they were looking to rebuild it in Europe. Moreover, the French political elite wanted to prevent Germany after the war to recuperate its natural weight in the center of Europe and to recuperate the lost territories. So the idea was to absorb Germany, to get it into a socialist European Union under the leadership of France. So the fight between the two visions goes on and on. It looks like the socialists are winning, the EU budget is growing and growing, there are ever more regulations, harmonizations. There's an implicit tendency for centralization because the European Commission has arrived of initiative for new legislation. So it seems like that the socialists are winning, but then something happens that Mises has predicted 70 years ago. No? The Berlin Wall comes down, and communism collapses, and this changes the scenario completely. The balance of power changes. So we have the two sides, the liberal and the socialist side. Why does the balance of power change? Well, first, when the Berlin Wall comes down, Germany, through reunification, gains in power. And Germany, on which side was it? Well, more to the classical liberal side. And the states of the East, Czechoslovakia, Poland, Hungary, and so on, they are pushing towards the European Union, towards Europe. And you know that best, they were a little bit tired of empires and socialism. So they would come in on this classic liberal side. So the balance of power was about to tip for forever against the socialists. So as a reaction, they just decided to accelerate the progress towards the central state and to intensify the efforts. And also to prevent a fast extension of the European Union eastwards, they thought that the European Union could degenerate then into a huge free trade area. What was their means, their step to speed up the process? Well, this was the single currency, the euro. So when the fall of the Berlin Wall also provided a unique opportunity for the French to get rid of the discipline of the Bundesbank. There was a saying that after the Second World War, the most dreaded institution in Europe after the Wehrmacht was the Bundesbank. Why? Because when the Bundesbank raised interest rates, France has had to raise interest rates also. Because otherwise they would have to devalue the French franc, which is very embarrassing. And it shows the population clearly, it's a clear sign, it's a smoking gun, that there has been inflation. What does it mean, higher interest rates? Higher interest rates imply less monetization of the French government debt. That means less French government spending possible. So by the imposed restrictive monetary policy imposed by the Bundesbank, French government spending is limited. So ironically, the losers of the war restrict the government spending of one on the winning side. Why was the Bundesbank more conservative than other central banks? Basically, because of the two hyperinflations that Germany had suffered in the 20th century, in 1903 and later after the Second World War. So even though German politicians also wanted more inflation, and they always fought against the Bundesbank, they could not win the battle because the Bundesbank had the broad support of the population. And all politicians that tried to attack the independence of the Bundesbank lost elections and votes. So they were posing by their restrictive monetary policy a limit for French inflation and French government spending. Of course, the French political elite did not like it. And they saw a threat to their power in this. They actually called it in a meeting of German-French officials at the end of the 80s. They were discussing the installment of short-range atomic weapons, French atomic weapons, at the border that could only explode in Germany. So the Germans were asking, well, can we do something about this? And the French responded, well, let's talk first about the German atomic weapon. And the Germans responded, well, you know that we are not allowed to have atomic weapons, and we don't have. And they say, well, we mean the D-mark, of course. So there you see how they see this, the power of the Bundesbank and the D-mark as a threat to their influence and power. So when the Berlin Wall came down, Mitterrand seized the opportunity and demanded a single currency. In fact, last September, the archives were opened, and it's now a proven fact that he did do so. He asked for the permission for reunification. He asked for the single currency. How could he exploit this situation? Well, Germany was still occupied by the four allies, was of course military vastly inferior to them. And Mitterrand threatened, if we don't go forward with European integration now, we will have, and this is also a quote, we will have a situation like 1913. You see all the implicit threats implied in this phrase. So this brought the end of the D-mark, which was a very important victory for the socialist side, because the euro provokes, as we will now see, sovereign debt crisis that can then be used for more centralization of political and fiscal power. And the end of the euro would most probably mean the end for a long time of the socialist vision. And therefore politicians do everything to defend the euro. Good. This about the history. Then I talk about in the book, why did high inflation countries want the euro? Why did Club Med wanted the euro? Well, the first point I have already touched upon, they wanted to get rid of the discipline imposed by the Bundesbank, and for France it was a power question. Then they could earn the prestige of the Bundesbank for the new currency, which would give them a tendency for a stronger currency and thus cheaper imports, higher standard of living. Then the point of seigniorage, which is interesting. Seigniorage is the profit from central bank money production. The profits of the ECB are shared not in function of the assets that the individual central banks provide or have, but in function of a number calculated by GDP and GDP and population. So where do the profits of the ECB come from? Well, from the assets, for the loans, for example, that the different central banks have. For example, the Bundesbank has its assets and receives interest rates, and at the end of the year they put it in a huge pool, and then they redistribute it back to the central banks. But not in function of the assets, because otherwise it would not make sense. They would just get back what they put in, but in function of GDP and population. So some win in this process, some lose. Germany loses, for example, France wins. Low interest rates. For government debt especially. Well, for two reasons, interest rates in southern European countries were reduced. First, the risk premium in interest rates were reduced because there came the implicit guarantee that the euro is irrevocable. There's no way back, and the euro will be always exist. So there was an implicit guarantee of the stronger countries to bail out the weaker countries, and guarantees that has now become explicit. So the risk premium of Spanish, Italian government debt decreased. We have to take into account that some countries at this point were already on the verge of bankruptcy, especially Italy. And inflationary expectations were reduced. You know that in interest rates there are also inflationary expectations priced in. So the story was the ECB will be as conservative as the Bundesbank, so with the euro inflation will go down, so interest rates went down, which gave these countries a margin for more debts and deficits, and a margin for more spending. It also gave them an excuse for austerity measures, like the argument, now we have to do these austerity measures to get into the club, the Euro club. They could sell their population better the austerity measures that would have been necessary in any case, as some were already on the verge of bankruptcy. Then there's monetary redistribution, that the money supply was growing fast in the south than in the core. And finally, yeah, the argument that they could get a stronger currency and thus more imports, the higher standard of living, so the population could be happier. Before the euro, when Germany would have less inflation than the South, and Germans would save and increase in capital goods, productivity would increase, then the D-mark would appreciate. There was a tendency for the D-mark to appreciate, and this would spread basically the benefits of the hard work of the Germans to all of the population. Why? Because imports would get cheaper. You could vacation more cheaply in Greece or Italy. Companies could import more cheaply, so the standard of living would increase by this continuous appreciation of the D-mark. Now this is not happening anymore, because the benefits of the are spread also to the south. The south has a stronger currency than they otherwise would have had, and cheaper imports. That coupled with the lower interest rates led to an import boom and consumption boom and construction boom. They used basically the interest rates, low interest rates, yeah, to build a housing bubble, to increase wages, yeah, and live beyond their means just by cheap new debts. Yeah. A few charts to illustrate that. So this is the illustration that the interest rates were coming down to the German level. You can see that the closer you get to the introduction of the euro, the more certain it becomes that certain countries get into the euro, the interest rates go down. Greece, that only joins the euro in 2001, is still higher. The others are approaching Germany, the red line. This is the illustration of the export surplus of Germany that is contrasted with the import surplus of Southern Europe. This is a long-term development of these trade balances. Here we can see that the South used cheap money and to increase wages. The competitiveness indicator based on unit labor costs rises, so the cost of labor per unit rises from 95 to 2010, especially for Ireland, but for all southern states. While on the contrary, for other states, it does not rise, or it even goes down, that is, productivity increases. In Germany, in the past 15 years, there were almost no wage increases, but increase in productivity, so the unit labor costs go down. So Germans work very hard, don't increase their living standards, and in the south there's party going on. You can also see this in this. The retail sales, like USA, France and UK between 96 and 2010, they increase while Germany, the standard of living is stagnating. And contrast this with a country like Spain that from 2000 to 2007, retail sales, consumption, increases more than 20%, then of course, after when the bubble bursts, it also collapses. Okay, after all these disadvantages, there's one more, the monetary redistribution, the illustration that the monetary growth was higher in the South, in Southern Europe, than in Germany. The thick blue line is Germany, which is the tendency, one of the lowest. You see around 2001 in Spain and Italy, they were very high. In 2006 and 7, again very high growth of M3. So after all this, and adding that the German population, many economists and lawyers that said that it would be unconstitutional to give up monetary sovereignty, were against the euro. The question is, why did Germany introduce the euro? Well, we have already talked about that Mitterrand asked for the single currency in exchange for his permission for reunification. But there were other reasons why the German political elite wanted the euro. One was that they themselves wanted to get rid of the Bundesbank. And they, for themselves, it was limiting their power and their spending. And many of them were were socialists. They wanted to go this, what they call European project, to go on. What is the project of a central European state? They wanted, for example, harmonization of tax rates. That we see this again, that they want to harmonize corporate tax rates now. Also, many interest groups wanted the European project to go on because they wanted harmonization of regulation. And harmonization of labor and environmental standards that were the highest in Germany, and they would have an advantage if these high standards would be imposed on the other members of the EU. So they wanted this project to go on and saw the EU as a means to achieve this. And then big exporters, they also were in favor of the euro because there were no devaluations were possible anymore, so the pressure to innovate would be reduced. And exporters, to some extent, they benefited from the euro, big exporters. And you see this also now that they defend the single currency. And you see this also on the stock exchanges that always when there are doubts that the euro will survive, then the DAX collapses, basically. While it's true that exporters benefited, we have to keep into mind that they fared very well before the euro also. And exports do not really make you happy. If you break it down to an individual person, when you export, you're selling, you're working, or you're selling your stuff, your laptop, for example, you're exporting. More interesting is when you're importing, when you buy a car or buy your groceries. If you could decide, if I could decide, well, Philip decide, do you want only to export, only to import? No, I would choose only to import, no? Who wouldn't? And actually this Southern Europe did that. They had an import surplus, while Germany has this export surplus. So even if we accept this argument, we have to be careful that exports per se doesn't make you happy. Finally, banks also. Why? Because the euro prevented a sovereign collapse. As I said, there were already states like Italy or Belgium that had very high debts and that could, through merging into the euro, they could go on. Their interest rates were reduced for them and collapse was prevented. And of course, banks were against or feared such a collapse. With a sovereign defaults, which could have brought down the European banking system and themselves. Okay, now to the money monopoly of the ECB. As you know, they can create base money, and the banking system creates on top of the base money fiduciary media, because they have the privilege of fractional reserves. So how does the monetization of government debt work? I first want to show the difference, the monetization, how it works, which is more direct, by the Fed, to some kind more honest. The government spends more than it receives in taxes. For the difference, the US government simply issues paper which puts bonds on it, or government bonds, treasury bonds. The banking system buys a large part of these bonds. Why? Because they know the Fed buys these bonds and then they receive more reserves, the banking system, and on top of these reserves they can do the very profitable business of money creation. At the end of the year, the government has to pay interest on the bonds, that are the ownership of the Fed. So the Fed has a profit, and the profit is then, the large part of it is paid back to the government. So it's not really a deficit that hurts very much. When the principal comes due, you just issue a new bond. The ECB, it's similar. The government, the several governments issue bonds when they have deficits, cover the deficits, and the banking system buys a great part of these bonds. And then they take these bonds to get loans from the ECB, and they have to pledge these bonds as collateral. And then at the end of the year, the government pays the interest to the banks, because the banks are the legal owners of the bonds, and the banks have to pay interest on the loans they have received from the ECB, and the ECB also remits the profits back to the governments. So the difference, yeah. So this is the bank holdings of government debt in the European Union. 2 trillion euros of government bonds are held by banks, which cannot surprise us very much, because they use the bonds to receive loans and reserves from the ECB. This has increased. This is a percentage. So almost 30% of all government debt are held by banks. And the US is less, it's less. Commercial banks hold only 11%. Because in the US it's different. There the Fed actually buys the bonds. So what is the difference between the two, between the Fed and the ECB? Economically it's very similar. In both cases the money supply increases. In the case of the ECB, the ECB accepts the bond as collateral and gives a loan. The money supply increases until the loan is not renewed anymore. And if in the US, the Fed buys the bond and the money supply increases until it sells it. So legally, in the EMU, the bonds remain property of the banks. They are off the balance sheet of the central bank. For example, we don't know how much government bonds are pledged as collateral at the ECB, or what kind of government bonds. And also, there's a difference between the interest rate that the government pays on the bonds and the interest rate that the banks pay for loans from the ECB. There's some money that leaks out in favor of the banks. In both cases, however, the bonds are effectively economically monetized. As that means there was a bailout of Greece going on even before the ECB started to buy the Greek bonds. Of course, what's the difference between buying these bonds and accepting them as collateral and renewing this for new loans and renewing this loans again and again? So there's another more indirect way to monetize the deficit, because of course we have here now seen 30% of government bonds are held by the banks. Where's the rest? Who has the rest? Well, government bonds are the preferred collateral. They have the lowest haircuts for the lending facilities of the ECB. So the government bonds are almost as good as money. If you are a bank and you have government bonds, you're fine. It's a very liquid reserve. Everyone wants them. You can take them and create and get new reserves and create new base money. So When a government has a deficit, part of the bonds are used as collateral for loans from the ECB, and then there's credit expansion by the banks because they receive new reserves. And some of this new money that is created then, and the secondary effect, is then invested again by financial institutions in government bonds. Why? Because they are such a liquid and asset and good assets. It's easier to see it in this graphical demonstration. Again, what I explained before, bonds are issued, borrowed by the banking system, pledged as collateral. The banking system has now new reserves. Let's imagine the banking system has bought 30% of the new bonds. Now the banking system has new reserves. What does it do? Well, it can expand credit. New money is created. For example, it gives new loans to a construction business. And the construction business pays its factors of production, its workers. So the new money flows to the workers. What do they do with the money? Well, some of it, the new money they consume, others they invest. They invest in hedge funds, in pension funds, investment funds. What do they do? What do they do with the new money? Well, part of the money, they buy the most liquid asset, government bonds. So this is a secondary monetization, indirect monetization. Okay. Now to the perverse setup of the euro system. So any government that has a deficit can just print bonds and use as collateral to get new money from the ECB, or the banks then can use them as collateral to get new money from the ECB. So this implies continuous effects because new money is produced. The first receiver of the new money benefits or wins because they buy at the old lower prices. Then the money spreads in the Eurozone and prices rise. So those people lose that have to pay these higher prices before their income increases. And the higher the deficits, the more money is produced. So you can see the incentives. If you have a higher deficit than the others, you profit. Imagine, for example, that Germany has a deficit of 3% of GDP, the German government. The rest of the Eurozone has a deficit of 10% of GDP. As a result, all this is monetized and prices rise 8% in the Eurozone. This means that real German government spending may actually fall, even though there's a deficit. So there's not only an incentive to have a deficit, but to have a deficit higher than the others, because only then you can externalize the costs on others. And the winner is, of course, the government with the deficit. The losers are the people in countries with lower deficits. So this is what I call the tragedy of the commons, therefore the title of the book, The Tragedy of the Euro. Property rights and money are not defended. It's a public money and therefore a tragedy of the commons. You can see it's like a printing press that has several owners, several users. Of course, those profit that use the printing press most, they can externalize the cost on all users of the euro in form of a loss in purchasing power. So governments with higher deficits gain on costs of governments with lower deficits. Of course, if there's a printing press, there's incentive to print as much money as possible, as fast as possible. Because if you don't do it, the other users of the printing press will do it. So there's an incentive to have deficits with monetary redistribution. So you see, this example of the printing press with several users is extreme and very visual. And in reality, there are some differences between the printing press and the euro system, because there are certain limits. Governments cannot print euros directly. They can only print the paper which puts print on it Greek government bond or Italian government bond. then the banks have to buy it, and the ECB has to accept them as collateral. So there are possible problems involved. First, obviously, that banks don't buy your bonds. And second, the ECB does not accept them as collateral. Why would banks not buy the bonds? Well, first of all, the interest rates could be from the bonds could be too low. Well, that is easy to solve. You just increase the rates. There could be that banks fear a default on the bond. They could also fear that there's a decrease in the rating of the government bond, and the ECB stops to accept the bond as collateral. Then there are risks implied, because government bonds normally are of a longer term, up to 30 years, and the loan that you get from the ECB is a week or a month. So imagine that you have a Greek government bond, 30 years, that gives you 10%, and you pledge it as collateral at the ECB to get a loan for a week. The loan doesn't only cost you 1%, so you have a profit margin of 9%. But of course, what happens after a week? You have to renew the loan with the ECB. So there's a risk that the ECB raises the interest rates. And there's a risk that the ECB says, oh, now the rating of the Greek government bond has been reduced, so now we don't accept them anymore as collateral. So we have a risk due to maturity mismatching that before the 30 years end, that there's a problem. Also, there's a haircut implied. If you have a Greek government bond of 1,000 euros, if you give it to the ECB, you won't get, as collateral, you won't get a loan of 1,000 euros, but only less, because there's a haircut. The second danger is, of course, that the ECB will not accommodate. So it might be that you, as a bank, you come with a new Greek government bond, and the ECB said, no, we won't give more loans out. We won't accommodate. We won't monetize. All these risks exist and explain why the euro still has not disappeared. But they are reduced very much because the euro, and here comes in the political analysis, is a political project. And markets knew that. There was, for example, there's no exit clause in the Maastricht Treaty, so there's no politicians have not thought about a way to exit the euro. So the idea was that the euro will exist forever, and this implies an implicit bailout guarantee, which reduces the default risk considerably, and also the rating risk. The ECB at the end is controlled ever more by political interests, and markets suppose that the ECB would come and help. And in fact, politicians say so, that the euro is a political project and it will continue. In fact, they say, we will do anything to save the euro, because the end of the euro is the end of Europe. This reminds me of the total war rhetoric of the Second World War. Okay. we will do anything against the evil speculators. I mean, how can you say something like this? Anything? Will they murder people? Are they already murdering people to achieve this end? So, the euro is a project of the socialists, and the ECB has actually demonstrated that it will support it. since the financial crisis, they will accommodate any demands for liquidity. So any government bond you give them, as a bank, you will receive more reserves. The ECB started to buy government bonds to support the project, even though it had said it would not do so. And the rating problem at the end is no problem either, because the ECB decided to accept Greek, Portuguese and Irish bonds, even though they are rated junk. There's another limit for this printing. You see all the politicians that can buy votes by government spending and deficits because they have indirect access to the printing press. So the political theoretical limit is the Stability and Growth Pact. It says there's a 3% limit of the deficit, 3% of GDP. So this would be like a strategy of the Commons with a quota, no? Like fishing strategy of the Commons, so every fisher has a quota of so many tons. And here we have the quota that the fishers that are the governments, they can, 3% of GDP, they can, the deficit can be monetized. Well, this could be work in principle if the fishers would only fulfill the quota. And if someone could impose penalties on the bad fishers that fish more than they should do. The Stability and Growth Pact has been a total failure because there are no automatic penalties. France and Germany, for example, had higher deficits from 2003 on. The small ones, even more like Greece. Of course, the small states always have incentive to use the printing press more and have higher deficits because they have higher likelihood to be bailed out. If you're a very big state, then there might be danger that the others are not strong enough to bail you out. But if you are Greece, it's easy to save. So until today, 73 times the limit of 3% was exceeded. And no one penalty was imposed. And the problem is that the governments are their own judges and determine if there should be penalties or not. In 2010, only two countries fulfilled the 3% rule, Finland and Luxembourg. So as these limits basically have been ineffective, and it's not clear that they ever will be effective, of course the euro is a political project, the euro is self-destructive. And it provokes high deficits and thereby ever higher amounts of debt and the sovereign debt crisis that we are experiencing now, that then is used for more centralization. Okay, here I think, well, for supper, no? Well, let's have a break.
We're gonna have a short break now for supper, so don't relax. Rest just a bit, feed yourself, and come back in 30 minutes.
Okay. So let me come to one question which I think is important, because they always say, well, the end of the euro is end of Europe, and the end of Europe is end of peace, and they basically say there will be war without the euro. I say, no, it's actually the opposite. It's a euro system that is not only unstable, but generates conflicts between nations. One pillar of classical liberalism is the idea that free trade generates peace between nations, and that government barriers between nations generate conflicts because they lead to autarky and the desire to get rid of these barriers via violent methods and war, while free exchange leads to pacific and harmonic cooperation. You get to know the others, you interact with them, you realize that you depend on them, that it's mutually beneficial. So that Germans send cars to Greece and do their vacation there or import feta cheese. So in the EU, this free exchange is disturbed in several ways. For example, by the redistribution by the cohesion and regional funds that rich countries are taxed and the money is transferred to poor countries to build roads, for example. But also through the euro in the system that I explained. There's monetary redistribution. If you take the example of Greece, that Greece uses subsidies, public government then spending to keep an uncompetitive economy rolling. There are too high wages, strong labor unions, inflexible labor markets. Normally that would result in huge unemployment. But they reduce the effects of this unemployment or hide it because they just pay unemployment benefits to the unemployed, or they hire them, public sector grows, or they send them, they pay them high and early pensions. So the problem of the unemployment is reduced actually by government spending, the cost of which can be, as I explained, externalized to other countries. The result is a deficit. So they issue bonds and the banks buy these bonds and they use them as collateral for loans from the ECB. The money supply increases and money prices go up. So there's a redistribution. Those who get the new money first, the Greek governments, and the people who receive it, the money from it, they profit and others lose. So the Greek minister who gets his salary and who buys BMW, he profits, then the money flows to Germany. And as the prices are very high and uncompetitive in Greece, the money stays in Germany and the prices go up there and there's a trade deficit. Like, basically goods are exchanged from Germany in exchange for new euros or debts that are never being paid. So this redistribution then may lead to conflict when it becomes more obvious, and it has become more obvious, because you cannot maintain an economy uncompetitive forever. So that led to the bailout in 2010 and the second Greek bailout in 2011. And then the redistribution became more obvious, and then we saw already the first conflicts. Some of the Germans think that that Greeks are lazy, they don't want to pay for the Greek welfare state, and they become, through the bailouts, they became aware that they were paying for the Greek welfare state. They were paying before, in form of this monetary redistribution, but then they got aware of it. And the Greek media, in exchange, demanded reparations for the Second World War. In fact, or recently, in May, a member of the Socialist PASOK party said to some German visitors, politicians, that if Germany would not bail out Greece again, their fellow German countrymen would suffer the same fate as the ones in Crete in World War II. You know, in Crete there was a fight where there was a kind of a loss for the Wehrmacht, so implicitly really threatening with violence. So the harmonic cooperation of the free market is substituted by conflict generated by the incentives of the euro system. So this leads me to the conclusion of my first lecture, that the euro is a political project, and it's naive to think, even though some people still speak about or tell this story, that the euro has been introduced to reduce transaction costs or to end monetary nationalism. It has been introduced to achieve centralization, a European super state that deals with the problems that the euro create and excessive debts. So there is, as I say in the book, And I still believe that there are three possibilities for the future. The first is to like impose quotas, basically, and reform the stability and growth pact, automatic penalties and strong ones for those that exceed the 3% limit, or maybe 0%. In fact, we still can see some intents in this direction, like last week or the week before, Italy and Spain voted for a debt brake in the constitution, which would be then some kind of enforcement of the limit. Of course, to achieve this, this would imply very hard reforms in these peripheral countries, privatizations, and when the companies are privatized, many will lose their jobs. The labor market must be flexibilized. Basically, labor unions have to be crushed. Government spending has to be reduced, and the standard of living must fall. So the question is, if this is really credible, this debt brake, and if they can do it. I'm skeptical, but everyone can have their own opinion on this. The second possibility is that the Eurozone splits. The first is that a country that does not want to go on with austerity measures leaves the Eurozone. Of course, this would be very stupid because they are now profiting from it, but they could be forced so because there's violence on the streets, riots, like in Greece. More likely is that someone like Germany says enough is enough and exits, even though I don't still see this. My fellow countrymen are like sheep. They are sheep. They protest against nuclear power. They start driving electronic cars. They basically pull the plug from cheap energy. This is important for them, but the exploitation through the Eurozone, they still do not resist. One problem is, of course, there's no media or big media, no political party that would be against the euro. They all are in favor of it. So if there's not very fast a new German Tea Party coming up, it's still far away, this possibility. So the most realistic one is the transfer union, centralization and economic government, something like the euro bonds, that the ECB continues to buy government bonds to keep the thing going. Then the incentives for the deficits will continue. The power of the central state will increase. Maybe they will be optimistic and say, like with the ECB. In the beginning, they said, well, they will be like the Bundesbank. So they will see when we will do an economic government and the Germans will impose austerity measures. And then somehow they will find out when they start voting that Germany and the Netherlands and Finland are in the minority. So this will then lead to this central state, and we see the first steps in this direction with the new European stability mechanism. And ever more calls for Eurobonds on economic government. So, here I will go to the second part of my lecture. What was F5?
Yes.
Okay. This is just the solution to the problem. You, of course, are in a very privileged position that you don't have this problem yet. You don't have to exit the euro. You just have to keep out of it. So if you are clever like the Greeks, you just falsify your statistics and put like 10% deficit of GDP or price inflation of 20%, and then you're not allowed to get in. You don't fulfill the criteria, and you're saved. You're saved. So this is the more difficult task is to get out of it. Nigel Farage of the Eurosceptic Party in the European Parliament, they asked me to write and present a paper how to exit the euro. So it's a work in process that I want to present here, and I would be grateful for your feedback. So to get first, you have to put forward, of course, the cost of staying within the European Union. And in the last lecture, I've talked extensively about it, of the tragedy of the euro. Of course, you can be on the winning side. There's a tendency for deficit spending and increase of the size of governments. There are bailouts, transfers, tendency for price deflation, centralization, loss of liberty. And last but not least, the conflicts between nations. So what are the problems that they say? Many people say it's basically impossible to exit. So what do they say? Well, first they point to the legal problems. They say that the Maastricht Treaty does not provide an exit clause. So they say you could not leave only the EMU, you would also have to leave the EU. So you can say, so what? So leave the EU also and become like Switzerland. And also you could easily renegotiate the entry. If you are like a net paying country like Germany, you could say, well, we leave both, and then we re-enter the EU if you want us to maintain your budget rolling. And then, of course, the legal argument is kind of funny, because the Maastricht Treaty did not provide for bailouts of countries either. And so you could argue the treaty, the spirit of the treaty has been violated. So people have the right to leave, or countries have the right to leave. Another problem that they talk about is the redenomination of contracts. Imagine that Germany leaves the Eurozone, and they redenominate all contracts within the country that are in Euro into a new D-mark. Okay, there's no problem. Then there might be a problem that, for example, if a German company had issued a bond in London in Euros, what happens with this bond? Will this be paid back in D-mark or Euros? Which law applies? German law or English law. So there may be some uncertainty in legal rulings necessary. More problems, economic problems. First, transaction costs. Of course, you have to print new D-marks and new coins and exchange this. Logistic problems, which are the same as when the euro was entered. Wage inflation. This is for countries like Greece with strong labor unions. If Greece, they say, okay, Greece could maybe solve their problems if they would just leave the European Monetary Union and would depreciate the new currency, so they would become competitive again. They would like depreciate 60%, would be competitive again. Yeah, but what about the strong labor unions? They could impose an increase in wages to compensate for that, like 60% also. So to have really a benefit to become competitive, you would have to reform also the labor market. Otherwise, the exit will not benefit you at all. Another economic problem is, of course, for Greece, for example, that Greece is now benefiting from the monetary redistribution that I mentioned before. So if you exit, you have to reduce your public sector. It will also likely to lead to a sovereign debt crisis. That is, they will default. So if Greece, for example, exits the euro, they will probably pay back their debts in the new drachma, which is depreciated, so it will imply a default on government debt. This will cause a banking crisis, not only of Greek banks, but then also of other European banks. That is the negative, and there will, even if Germany, for example, exits the euro, there may be a negative feedback from sovereign defaults. Because if the D-mark then appreciates, there will be losses if, for example, then Greece pays back their bonds in the depreciated currency. Well, they also talk about the political costs. First, it would be the end of the famous euro project. The country that would leave would be a second-class member of Europe. It would be or it would be in the club of Switzerland, or the club of UK, Sweden, Poland. And the European Union as itself, as it would be the end of the euro project, would probably lose its status of a global power on the same level, or almost on the same level, as the US. So there we might say, who cares? Who cares? More important are the procedural costs, because there almost necessarily is a time between the discussion of the exit and the issuance of the new currency. So imagine that in the Greek, and there's a problem that we have democracies in these countries. So imagine that Greece, in the Greek Parliament, they start to discuss: shall we exit the euro and introduce a new drachma? You can imagine what this leads to. There will be a flight of capital, of deposits. There will be a de-drachmatization, basically. All drachma will be, all euros will be transferred to German banks or Dutch banks. So if they want to introduce a new drachma, maybe there will be no euros left to be exchanged. There will be a banking crisis because people try to get all their deposits in cash. On the contrary, if Germany, for example, starts to discuss in the parliament and starts this public discussion, we are thinking about leaving the euro, then probably people will expect an appreciation of the new D-mark and will transfer the deposits into German banks. So ever higher part of the European money supply will be in German banks. And if Germany then really leaves the euro, the Bundesbank will finally be the new ECB, which was supposedly the idea in the first place, that the Bundesbank really controls the money supply. There might be negative feedback for banks if there are defaults in the other countries, like German banks that have peripheral debts on their balance sheets. And the target 2 claims increase due to this capital flow. And the target 2 claims maybe you haven't heard about, which is interesting. I will talk about now. So there may be a banking crisis in each case. If Greece leaves, there will be a banking crisis, and if Germany leaves, there will also be a banking crisis because there will be losses. There will be losses for German banks because basically now Greek banks are only maintained, keeping afloat by the implicit German bailout guarantee. So they will go belly up and may lead to a European banking crisis. Anyway, the banking crisis, we are already in a banking crisis, and it will occur anyway. it's now only being contained by the ECB and the taxpayers of the core countries. So, being that we will have, or we have, a banking crisis in any case, and we need a recapitalization of the banks, how to do it? I mean, if there will be an exit from the euro, you have to do it immediately. So how could you solve the problem? A free market solution would be, well, let the inviolable banking projects just fail, which frees up capital for other banks, do a change in ownership, a debt to equity conversion, that the debtors of the banks are converted into shareholders, and recapitalization, that banks try to get capital on the markets, which is already occurring. And then have finally a sound banking system again, because now we don't have one, and we have to solve the problem immediately if there's an exit. What is the advantages of such a solution to the banking crisis? Well, taxpayers don't have to pay. There's just a change in ownership. The debtors become shareholders. The old shareholders may lose everything. Unsustainable financial projects are eliminated. There's no more havels because there's no bailout of shareholders, and there's no inflationary policy to save banks. One problem is also the disentangling of the ECB. First of all, you have reserves pooled in the ECB. One good thing is that each central bank has still its own balance sheet. But some reserves have been pooled in the ECB, so you would have to negotiate a return of the capital contribution, which might be difficult in the case of Germany, for example. If if Germany leaves the euro, the ECB might say, well, then you lose your capital. Your capital contribution. Right? And then they could answer again, well, then you will lose our contribution to the EU budget. And then the target two claims and debts. If Germany has already claims in the target two, and that means the Bundesbank has claims against the ECB in euros. If the new D-mark appreciates, this means the euros, this assets imply losses for the Bundesbank. I know that some Austrians think that losses for central banks are irrelevant. No? I don't agree here, but we can talk about this later. And Greece, has, for example, debts, target two debts, which probably it would, if it would exit, would default, which would imply losses for the ECB. So let's explain a little bit how target two works. Here we have a German bank that gives a 3 month loan to a Greek bank. The Greek bank lends to a Greek company which imports a BMW. This was before the financial crisis. Then comes the financial crisis, and German banks don't trust Greek banks anymore. And now the Greek bank needs to pay back the loan after 3 months. So what happens? It goes to its central bank. It goes to the central bank of Greece to get the money, and it pays back the money to the German bank. The same happens if now a Greek citizen gets frightened that the Greek would exit the euro, and he transfers his deposits to a German bank. So what happens in the euro system? Basically, the Greek bank uses its reserves that it has at the Central Bank of Greece, which gets a debt to the Bundesbank, and the Bundesbank gives more reserves to the German bank. That is, the Bundesbank has a claim in euros against the Central Bank of Greece or the ECB, which is not settled, and the Central Bank of Greece has a debt against the Bundesbank. The German bank has now more reserves at the Bundesbank. It will probably reduce its loans from the Bundesbank. I've put it there that less loans. And of course, the Greek bank has also a problem because it has lost reserves at the Central Bank of Greece and will therefore probably demand additional loans. It's easy to say, see it with the balance sheet. And the left-hand side is the balance sheet of the Central Bank of Greece, on the right-hand side, the balance sheet of the Bundesbank. We have here, you remember the Greek bank has to pay, let's assume, 1 million euros as a deposit. So the 1 million euros are transferred to the German bank that has more reserves. And at the same time, there's a debt of the Greek Central Bank created to the Bundesbank that has a claim on the Central Bank of Greece. These are the target two claims and debts. And normally what would happen would be, because the Greek bank loses reserves, it will ask for a new loan, and the German bank will reduce its loans from the Bundesbank. So this is a problem of target two, that there would be huge capital inflow into German banks, and the Bundesbank would have euro claims against the ECB, the euro system. So if Germany then leaves and the euro loses in value, there will be losses for the Bundesbank, which may be a problem. So what are then the best ways to leave? One is a complete redomination. So redominate all euros in your countries into the new currency, like one-to-one is the easiest way. Now, the first way is to discuss it in parliament. So then you have the problem of Greece that there's a capital outflow, and Germany that there's a capital inflow. Of course, these are not problems, but solutions for the citizens, because the Greeks, for example, save their wealth from expropriation by this capital flight, and if they transfer to Germany, German assets rise in value, and Germany, or actually the Bundesbank, controls the monetary policy in Europe, because almost all the, or a great part of the money supply is suddenly in German banks. But this might be not the best solution because of this capital movements. Well, of course, you could do a surprise move, like on a weekend, say emergency law, declare bank holidays, change the bank software from euro into D-mark. How could you legitimize that? Well, you could say, well, it's a true will of the population. We haven't asked the population before when we introduced the euro, so now we won't ask them again. It's an emergency situation to prevent great evil. So you might be able to legitimize this. But maybe the most elegant way would be to do a provisional redenomination, like also on a weekend, to say, let's redenominate provisionally for 6 months our contracts in Germany into D-mark. And then we have time to negotiate the exit, to have a public discussion, to have a parliamentary debate. We can even do a referendum. And after 6 months, then there will be a decision if there's an exit or not. So we fulfill the criterion that it's democratic, that there is a discussion. And the speculative capital flows are prevented because they are surprised. And then you have, during the 6 months, you have just dual accounts. You have the euro accounts and the D-mark accounts at the German banks. And of course, you have these letters on the notes where you can see from which country the bills are from. So it's no problem to exchange all notes that were issued by the Bundesbank against D-mark in 6 months. A second way would be, instead of redenomination, would be to issue a new currency, which was it was akin to the British proposal of 1990. The advantage would be you could exit the euro system, so there would be no more bailout costs, so no losses from the EFSF, ESM, or from ECB operations. You could issue a new currency backed by gold or other assets the central bank has. You can issue it by paying your government bonds or paying public employees. So, and then you can discuss this matter. And there are no capital movement flight problems, no democratic problems. There's capital and there's currency competition. And the third way is true currency competition, especially for that is might be interesting for a small country like Slovakia, where they say we cannot issue a new parallel currency because markets will not trust this currency. So they just declare everything, or they exit the euro and say no legal tender laws anymore. Well, what would happen in the beginning would be probably euroization, that is, the people would continue to use euros. Well, the advantage would be, of course, Slovakia would not have to pay the bailouts of Greece, and it has a higher per capita income than they anymore, and share the losses of the ECB. Of course, they would not be protected against the inflation of the euro, but also the faster they keep inflating the euro, the faster they probably end euroization and other currencies, Swiss francs or gold, would be introduced, and there would be true currency competition. Lastly, accompanying measures. With no changes, no accompanying measures, the exit of, for example, Greece would be a total disaster. There would be huge unemployment, huge big inflation, capital flight, banking crisis. So what are the measures to facilitate actually the exit? Well, in general, what you have to achieve is that the market thinks that the new currency will be less inflationary than the euro, and then you won't have capital flights, but actually capital that comes in. This, of course, is more difficult to achieve for a country like Greece than a country like Germany. What are these measures? Well, banking reform, as I said before, solving the banking crisis, and monetary reform. Maybe if Greece backs the new drachma with the gold they have, there will be no capital flights. Eliminate the public deficit, because the public deficits, there's always a danger that it will be later monetized and will reduce the trust and the confidence in future currency. Restructure your old debt, that is, default on your old debt. This has also the advantage that the government cannot issue so easily more new debt. This could gain confidence for the new currency. Of course, privatize, freeze up capital, deregulate, flexibilize, especially the labor market, and lower taxes. All this helps to make the transition as pleasant as possible, because they free up capital for the transition and for the bank capitalization. They boost economic growth, that also helps, and it generates confidence. And the restructuring of the old debt and the elimination of the deficit eliminates incentives for inflation, also reduction of union power. So my conclusion is that with all the costs implied in the euro, especially they are rising day by day, and all the risks they include, it's like the perfect opportunity to solve many problems at a time, to introduce a sound currency and reform the banking system and reduce the size of the state. Staying within the euro, the size of the state will keep increasing. There will be a new central state in Europe sooner or later. So, But these are no problems that concern you. You are the lucky poet. You are outside Europe. Well, thank you very much for your attention. And I'm open for your questions.
Any questions, any comments?
Yeah, so actually from what you said right now, it seems that basically the cost of either country leaving the EU, I mean the monetary union, the cost for the Mediterranean countries would be much, much greater than for Germany, regardless of how it happens. So could Germany just use this as leverage to actually reform the monetary union instead of leaving? What do you think about that?
Maybe my voice is
okay. I agree. It would be. They always think if Greece leaves the euro, it would be totally stupid for them in these conditions to leave. If they leave, they really have to make sure that the currency is supposed to be stronger than the euro, which is kind of difficult. For Greece would require measures like those that I mentioned. So it's not impossible. So you say they could use it as a leverage to reform the euro. Saying that if you don't do these reforms, we leave. No.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, they could do. The problem for them, if they do it openly, there will be immediately the banking crisis and the market turmoil. There will be a pan-European banking crisis. I think immediately if they do it openly. Maybe they do it in their private discussions. They do it. Until now, it has not really worked. There has been privatization plans for Greek. They don't do it. And they said they, even though they missed their targets, they won't do anymore. The problem is really the structure, the social political structure in these countries, with very strong labor unions. I know it from Spain. You can't believe how much power these labor unions have in society. What kind of privileges they have, how much subsidies they receive by the government, and how much the political parties really fear these labor unions. And Spain, for example, won't get onto its feet, probably if they won't do a real reform of the labor market, but I don't see it happen now. So they are between the two. The Germany is pressuring to do the reforms, but they have their own problems, their own labor unions that don't want it to be done. Who is the nearer? Yeah. The labor unions in your country or Merkel that you have seen blinks all the time? She just gives in because she wants to continue the status quo, and so she knows that her threat actually is not credible. Right now, her threat to leave the euro is not quite credible. Therefore, I think therefore it doesn't work right now. The threat.
You mentioned that every time there is a crisis, the tendency is to go for more centralization. Well, Europe isn't the only one with a currency problem. The US has a currency problem as well. If they put their heads together and decide to establish the Keynesian nightmare of one unified world currency, what are your thoughts on that? Is that likely to happen?
Well, this would be probably the next step, no? And it would be much, it's much easier to deal with this with the euro and the dollar. If you have only the euro and the dollar and not a D-mark and Dutch guilders and so on. So the euro has already been a step towards this one single fiat currency, but I don't see it right immediately coming. I don't see it immediately coming. Maybe if there's really a huge crisis and really everything goes to hell, then they might use the opportunity to do something with this. The huge problem, of course, is that you would have the same as in the euro system. You have to think about this. If you have one single central bank that produces new money and with fiat money, they have fiat money because they want to produce more of it. So if you produce more of it, how do you split the profits from it? How much profit goes to the United States? How much goes to Europe? The same problems we have here with the euro. Because will the new central bank accept as collateral only US debt, government debt, or also German or Greek government debt? And if so, is there a limit? How can this limit be imposed? Maybe it can be only work then if we have a central world government. And will the crisis be so big that we can go very fast to a central, to one world government? But of course, this would be a total nightmare. But you see the problems here.
Well, my question is that what do you think about the fact that contrary to what you wrote in your book, most of the world, from what I know at least, seems still to think that EU is mainly a German job. So contrary to what you wrote, that it is mainly Frenchmen are just hidden behind the whole European Union. Still, many people across Europe, mainly Europe, still think that that the Germans are behind it. Is it just a success of? Is it just an effect of a successful propaganda from the part of the socialist group within the EU? How do you think?
Yes. Well, if I can elaborate a little more, yeah. Many people, if you read the literature, many people point to this, that France always has been the leader of the European project. The saying was that France, or in the literature they say France puts the policies and the strategies and Germany pays for it. Or Charles de Gaulle himself said Europe is like a carriage, or the European Union is like a carriage. Germany is the horse and France is the driver. So, of course, the general population now has the impression because Merkel is pressured by the German population to demand austerity measures. So the Greeks make responsible Merkel and the German population for the things that Merkel demands. But she has no other choice. She is actually losing all elections already. You can see finally the German influence in the idea that the Bundesbank would be like German run, no? And we have seen this with Axel Weber. Axel Weber was supposed to be the next. Well, in the beginning it was the Dutch Duisenberg, and then came Trichet, which was before a French finance minister and president of the French central bank. Actually, in the time before the introduction of the euro, Trichet was against independence of the new ECB, and during all the crisis he has been just a servant to the European project, and to the interest of the French political elite and banking system, and of course the interest of the French banking system is not so much different from the German banking system's interest and political elite either. But Bundesbankers have basically no influence. That demonstrates that even though Axel Weber was supposed to be the new president of the ECB, he stepped down. Why did he step down? Well, his official explanation was because he's in a minority position there. Club Met with France in its leadership is just the majority. And the votes of Italy and France, they can vote down any proposition as a president. So he knew that he had no chance to become the new president because his views were not inflationary enough. He was against the purchase of direct purchase of government bonds by the ECB. So to say that Germans are really behind it makes me laugh.
In recent weeks, instead of anyone exiting the Eurozone, we saw actually Switzerland, in some sense, joining the Eurozone. And now there's my question, what are the consequences for the Eurozone, the Europe, and for countries like Poland? Is there any threat that countries like Poland and Czech Republic will somehow get sucked into the Eurozone in some form?
Yeah, this was really interesting. The movement of the Swiss National, the move of the Swiss National Bank, which was of course had a very negative effect immediately on all people who own Swiss franc, especially the Swiss, which I suppose have most of it. It's really suicidal to plug your currency again to a currency that is so vulnerable, like the euro, with so high risks of inflation. So probably this guarantee is not really credible, and that they will go to the bitter end of it. So what is the effect for Poland? Czech, I think they are already in the exchange rate mechanism, no? So to some extent they are also in a similar position like the Swiss. If I'm correct, you have to be in the exchange rate mechanism for 3 years to join the euro, and you have to try to be, it's like 15%, I think, that your currency can move. So the idea would be, of course, to get out of the exchange rate mechanism.
But we are not.
You're not, why not? You say, you don't have to go into it?
Well, we have to, but there is no set date, so we can basically
Okay.
Explode it.
Okay, so you're safe. Always remember, falsify your statistics in the opposite way of Greece. You will be safe. You don't need it. You don't even need it.
Yeah. Which currency crisis do you think is more imminent, the euro or the dollar? And if it's the euro, do you think it will trigger the crisis in US? Uh,
All these timing questions are extremely difficult to answer, and more for a speculator investor to answer, no, not for an economist. What is my personal opinion if I put aside the economic theory, like just my feeling? Yeah, of course, the euro might be more imminent because there may be happening something any day. Anyway, there might be happening something that Finland does something unexpected, or in Greece happens something, or there's a downgrade of France. The situation is more stable in the US. There the problem is increasing slowly, constantly, while we are already in a very crisis mood in the Eurozone. So which explodes first, I don't know. But it may happen earlier in the Eurozone because there's already such a situation that's very unstable. It looks like they are coordinating very perfectly, actually. They are inflating, or they are doing very extreme measures at the same time, in such a way that the exchange rate stays more or less in a small band. And now the Swiss always join the club. The Bank of England is no better. They are always coordinated with their American friends, and the Bank of Japan is in the same club. So this is the reason why we don't really notice the extreme measures that are going on in these countries. Why exchange rate fluctuations?
Nie dostaliśmy tylko jeden mikrofon, czy będzie dużo szybciej, że będziemy te pytania mówić głośno, zadawać. Także Mateusz, tak, był drugi.
Okay, you mentioned losses suffered potentially by a central bank on this target to claims. And you mentioned it's a cost of leaving euro, but if you think about it, central bank loses, so it will pay less money to a budget of a German government, and therefore there will be a burden of public spending on private economy in Germany would be reduced, so it's more like an advantage.
That's a good argument. Of course, your assumption is that if they have less income from the central bank, they will reduce public spending. They might not. They might hold it constant and increase taxes or increase the deficit. But if it would be so, it would be an advantage. Yeah. But the losses might be. Remember that on the liability side, all will be denominated in D-mark. And on the asset side, you have this euro assets that lose in value, so you might have many losses. I know a central bank cannot go bankrupt in the sense that that it cannot pay their bills, because they can just produce the money to pay their bills, so they cannot be economically bankrupt. But their balance sheet can be balance sheet insolvency, which could be a problem for the new currency, in my opinion.
But is it like the Bank of Czech Republic, like has negative own capital, and Corona is like doing great?
When?
Now.
Right now. I would like to see the numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah. Please send me this information for it and. Why it happened. I only say that it's better for a central bank to have good assets than bad assets. Like, imagine that the Fed says, oh, we looked in Fort Knox and actually there's no gold left. which might be true, no, we don't know.
But Nike told it. They have only some
so this would reduce, might be lead to negative capital. You might think that nothing else happens, but I would think it would be negatively affect the value of the dollar, because the asset that the central bank has, it can use to defend, even though there's no redemption, you can use to defend your currency, you can sell the assets, buy your currency back, you can defend in foreign exchange markets, and when it comes heart to heart, you can do a currency reform. I mean, if Greece, for example, leaves the euro and wants to introduce their own currency, if they have nothing to back it, if they have no gold, nothing, they're really in a bad position. Or look at the Central Bank of Iceland. The Central Bank of Iceland actually went bankrupt. They couldn't save their banking system. They couldn't save their banking system because the banking system had debts in foreign currency. And the Central Bank of Ireland did not have enough gold or foreign currency to save their banks. At this point, the assets of the Central Bank of Iceland was basically only loans to an insolvent banking system. They couldn't save it, the government couldn't save it. At this point, the Icelandic krona collapsed and price inflation picked up, even though there was no huge expansion of the money supply, only normal expansion. So I think if they would have had better assets, gold or foreign exchange, this would not have occurred. So I think that the assets of a central bank are important. And in this case, in the target two, the claims would, an appreciation of the DMARC would lose in value, and it might be bad for the confidence in the currency, and the German government might actually have to recapitalize. Bundesbank.
Yeah, I wanted to ask the following. Germany is one of the biggest holders of physical gold right now. You mentioned your country ran as a ship at the beginning of introducing euro. This could have changed the market over the years, and right now it might be that a lot of parties have some second thoughts about the euro. Particularly, you emphasize the Greek problem, but I feel the real problem for Germany is that for France is that their banks are exposed to Greece very heavily, and if these banks, say German banks, are bailed out by Germany, period, then they wouldn't have much hard feeling about cutting off Greece. And then you mentioned here something if here is going to happen some change, it must be rather abrupt and take markets by surprise. So the question here is, the side of Merkel, doing as she is doing, is it not a chance that the official form of what is happening, what we see, is some kind of playing for time, for say let's go over half a year or something, while some people in Germany just basically plotting going alone. They don't say, of course, well, we are just sick because then there is no euro tomorrow. But somebody has to have some plan B. Say, okay, if we start bailing out of Michelin or Italy or something, then we go nowhere. We have to take care at some point for ourselves. Perhaps propose some much smaller union. So the question is, do you see that may be some kind of plan B on the table discussed with Germany, with Merkel functioning as kind of you know, general icon, you know, doing play for time, and serious people are discussing details of something like, I don't know, gold-backed currency or something like that.
It would be too good to be true. I personally, they may have thought of a plan B. There are rumors about it, but I don't think they are seriously considering it. I just don't trust them. if you look at their behavior, for example, the first bailout of Greece, Merkel said, no, it's against the Maastricht Treaty, there will be no bailout of Greece. There was an important election for her, not only Westphalia, she didn't care, there was a bailout. At this point, she could have stopped the thing earlier, much, much earlier. Maybe the Eurozone could have survived, just there would have been a default of Greece and a banking crisis they have dealt with. But she continued, and I think she might really believe in what she says, that the Euro is, without the Euro, Europe will not survive, there will be war. Something like this, and you have to see that they only think very short term, and they want to survive the next few days, next few months, and there's a huge pressure from some interest groups that want to maintain the status quo. Also, all the big media in Germany are, of course, in favor of this what they call European project. The big multinational companies are also in favor. It's the banks are in favor, and remember that the banks are financing the government. So all the establishment basically is in favor of it. It would be great if they would have a plan B and would actually do that. I would love very much.
We must stop at this point, but happily we can continue at the other room in the restaurant, where you are all invited to wine reception in a few minutes. So thank you very much, everybody, for the participation of the first day. And thank you, Philip, in the first place.